So I want to thank everybody for joining the session today. These are extraordinary circumstances. And as George said, George Washington University, like every other institution, has turned everything online. So we are trying to deal with this situation here, working from home. Hopefully by the time you arrive in the fall, everything will be running normal. So let me start by congratulating you for your success in entering the program, by getting the invitation actually to join. I have prepared a few slides. I will go through them very quickly so that I leave enough time for questions and answers at the end, because I think that's where the real thing is, right? The presentation, you will see it on online. So the program is very, very flexible. This program consists first of two courses. These are two courses that everybody needs to take. The first course over there, the ISTP Cornerstone, you will take the very first semester in the fall that you are entering. The second course builds on the first, and it's a deeper discussion of science and technology policy. You will take it some in one, the second or the third semester that you are with us. At the very end of your studies, when you are about to finish, you will take a capstone course, which comes in a sequence. You take two credits preparing you for the course in advance, and then you take two more credits later on. This is also a requirement. Everybody does this. During your studies, of course, each one will specialize on a different field of your choice. You are given basically total freedom to make up your field. What you see here in this slide are just some fields that are predetermined, but you really do not have to go with one of those. You can come to the program director and you can craft your own. Right. And then we will need to see what kind of sequence of courses you will need to take in order to achieve this. At the very beginning, the very first semester of your studies, you will complete a program of studies, and that's when you will discuss with the director of the program what exactly your program is going to be and what you want to do. So here, there are 15 credits. There is a very wide choice of courses that you can take. Not only courses taught by our faculty, but definitely all courses taught by any Elliott School faculty and beyond that across the university. And I must mention across many universities in the region, because GW is part of a consortium, university consortium in the major Washington metropolitan area. This consortium actually serves a great purpose. If there is a course that GW does not offer, but you find in one of our partner institutions, it's very, very easy to justify taking the course over there instead of at GW. And this is very easy, up to two courses. So if you have something very specialized that you need and we don't offer it, you can go to Georgetown, or you can go to Johns Hopkins, or you can go to some other university around here and take the course, Maryland and so forth. Okay? This is a great feature actually of the program. Then we have, there is a section in the program, this so-called analytical competency. Now here you have to put together two courses that sort of serve as background, building a background for you in analyzing policy. It can be mathematics, for example. It can be statistics. It can be economics courses. It can be business courses. Something that you can say helps you in addressing policy decision making. Right. There is a lot of courses throughout GW, and people here also take courses in the School of Public Policy, in our School of Public Policy. and then at the end, there is, of course, room for electives and skills courses. Now, the skills courses are particularly very interesting. The Elliott School has several, a big collection of them. These are taught by non-GW faculty. This is professionals that reside in the area here who teach these specialized courses that on a very specific applied theme, each one. They meet for a few times. It's not a semester-long course. It may meet five times during the semester, and it is totally flexible. So the particular thing of this course is that they are taught by non-GW faculty. So these must be professionals. Now, the highlights, I think I have already mentioned, it is highly customizable. It is very much interdisciplinary. The location in the middle of Washington cannot be stressed more for a program dealing with policy. Just being three blocks from the White House is important because that's how far we are from the White House. We can almost hear the president these days raising his voice. We are next to the World Bank, next to the IMF, the International Monetary Fund, that is. And across the school, you can see the Department of State and several other federal agencies. So the location is superb for policy studies, and the course offerings by the university and by all the partner universities, as I mentioned, is immense. Now, in the suite, we have our own suite, right? In the suite, you will find four full-time regular faculty located there all the time. These are people that are always there. But I wanted to very much stress the difference in the fields of each one. And then in the next slide, a series of other people who are closely affiliated with our program. And I when I say closely affiliated, I mean really closely. They may offer courses, they advise students who are affiliated. They are not a regular faculty, but they have offices in the suite, and they are highly accessible, right? These are all very good people. In fact, the two ones at the end, Sharon Squassoni and Al Tyke, they are in the suite, right? Now what you can do with such a degree, what you can do is to get great internships and get great jobs. I'm sure some of you are, all of you are thinking, what do I do with this, right? The easiest way to get your head around this is to think which are the agencies, the federal agencies and the state government agencies that spend money on research and development. Who does research? Who funds research? Who actually is interested in new products, new processes? Who is interested in space? Who is interested in maritime? Who is interested in food production? Who is interested in pandemics today? So these are the agencies that at least the government who will be the most probable employer of yours. The next step is to think about international organizations. All the international banks are excellent employers. So the World Bank has taken several of our graduates. The Inter-American Development Bank, that too. Actually, the World Bank, as I said before, is just two blocks away. The Inter-American Development Bank may be 10 blocks away. But also the East Asian Bank, the African Bank for Development, and so forth. All these banks, exactly because they are interested in promoting international development of the country members, obviously they're terribly interested in technology and innovation, because that's the basis of development, right? For those of you who would like more social work, there are a large number of nonprofits where you can work. Several of them are here in town, like the Woodrow Wilson Center, for example, is a major, excellent place to get a job or get an internship. But other places like the ITIF, which is Information Technology Institute, right? And the SRI, which is a sort of a hybrid of non-profit and profit organization, are fantastic. There are many, many others, including RTI, the Institute RTI, and so forth. Finally, for those of you who are more profit-oriented, obviously the private sector is interested these days in science, technology, and innovation. I don't want to belabor the point, but anytime you open a newspaper or you go to a magazine, you can see the role of technology and innovation all over the place, from the beginning to the end. These days, due to this major disaster that we have, obviously everybody is looking up to technology to come up with a new vaccine. Okay, going forward, connections, alumni. The program this year in 2020 is celebrating its 50th anniversary, 50. The program was established formally at GW in 1970, and it has run uninterrupted since then. So in the first 50 years of operation, we have produced a very significant number of graduates, out of who a very large proportion is in Washington. They work here in all those organizations that I mentioned before, all the type of organizations. And one of the things that the program does well is to connect you with such people. Everybody understands the importance of this, the importance of finding alumni who are successful and working in good programs already to take in new qualities. And finally, I think we're reaching the end, there are opportunities to study abroad. We strongly recommend that your second semester and maybe the third semester, definitely not the first or the last or the fourth, let's say, if you are full-time students. Just think of it like this. If you are for four semesters at the Elliott School, let's say the first and the last are not advisable to go abroad. Somewhere in between, you could. And there are excellent schools around the world with which the Elliott School has working agreements that you can visit and take courses. This includes universities in Europe, in Japan, and other countries, but primarily these two, several universities, at least for us, for our program, right? I always talk about our program. Several universities in Europe are pretty strong, and if you want to go abroad and you want to live abroad and study there, we strongly recommend some. For example, the University of Maastricht in the Netherlands, in a city called Maastricht, which is really at the heart of Europe and not very far away from the European center of decision making, which is Brussels these days. Now, I talked a little bit at the beginning, and you can look at the details yourselves. The program is 50 years old. It's run by this institute, the Institute for International Science and Technology Policy, which actually has the same age as the program. It also was established in 1970. I am the director of the institute also. We have a sister institute. It's the Space Policy Institute, and here is where our cohort of students coalesce around space policy. We have some great people in this institute with the best experience and the widest knowledge. I think it's a unique institute in the country. I don't think there's many competitors or any actually great competitor to it. And I strongly recommend that you get around these people, my colleagues. To finish, the Elliott School is very rich in terms of programs, in terms of faculty, in terms of visitors, and I strongly recommend when you arrive here to actually go beyond our institute and participate in other programs where you will find your future colleagues sitting next to you in classes. And I will leave it at that. If there are any questions, I will be happy to answer.
Dr. Vonortas, I'll help read some of the questions that have come through already.
Please.
We have a student that is asking for more details of the space policy path.
Mm-hmm. It's just that, more details of the space policy path?
Correct, yeah. Could you just provide him a little bit more detail about specializing in the space policy area?
Sure. Okay, the space policy field is led by my colleague, who is, I will go back to show you his name. This is the colleague, Professor Hertzfeld, Henry Hertzfeld. He is the director of the Space Policy Institute, and he would be the best person to get in touch directly for any detail you want. You can find his contact on the Elliott School site. This field is extremely important because for people who are interested in everything that is above the commercial airlines, where a commercial plane flies. It includes from satellites and out. You understand that space is part of our lives today. I don't need to tell you that the internet very much depends on space, and that GPS is very much space related. That would suffice, but that is only a very small part of space policy. There is many other things. For example, our colleague that you see here, I'm just mentioning his circling his name right down here, Scott Pace, is currently serving as the executive director of the Space Policy Council of the United States. Scott's boss, direct boss now, talks to Vice President Pence. This is extremely important operation, and these are the kinds of caliber of people that we have for this. In this list of faculty, Pascal Ehrenfurth, our colleague, is one of the utmost international experts in things of space policy. She's actually leading the German space agency. Several others, like Peter Hayes and other people here, are dealing with space policy. Jobs, if you're asking about jobs there, depending on your specialization, there is a large number of companies around the Beltway of Washington, and there is NASA. Usually these are the places, so it will be NASA in terms of federal agencies, it will be consulting companies that relate to space, and it will be companies that actually deal with space, like SpaceX of Mr. Musk that you see always in the news. I hope that this is enough.
Great, thank you. Our next question is, how can the capstone and possible internship opportunities help students find relevant work in big and exciting organizations?
Yes, very good. Let me go with internships, start with internships. We strongly recommend, we cannot oblige, of course, people, but we absolutely strongly recommend that during your studies and being in the middle of Washington, you get either one or more internships. There's a lot around here, a lot of places to intern during your studies, or you get a job. Many of your colleagues, as you will realize, will be employed. I guess you have noticed that all our courses, the graduate courses at GW, are taught in the evening. And the reason they are taught in the evening is that actually many people work around here. So there is no excuse, basically, for you not to get a very good internship in this town. And in this region, and that will be a big part of your ticket to a good job later on at graduation. So that is for industries, but for the capstone now is centralized, is run by the school itself, and I think the capstone will help you by putting you together with other colleagues that have similar interests, but a very different way of looking at an issue. To give you an idea, we are dealing today with a pandemic, right? We have a coronavirus around here, and it's bothering us. You may deal with, you may look at this issue from the economics point of view, you may look at this issue from the public health points of view, you may look at this issue from the pharmaceutical company's point of view, you may look at this issue from international relations point of view, and so forth. So creating teams in the capstone with people who are interested in a particular topic, but from different viewpoints and different backgrounds will be an amazing experience. Many of these projects actually link to organizations in this town and elsewhere, organizations that deal with a particular topic that the students, the project that the students choose.
And I think we have time for one more question. So to kind of go off of internship opportunities that you just spoke on, we have a specific to international students. So do you know of any examples of ISTP students who were able to get internship opportunities as an international student in the public or private sector?
In the private sector, is this?
In the public or private sectors.
In the public or private sectors. Obviously, the limitation of the international students is the visa. They will not have a working visa, and that creates some limitations in getting out and getting jobs. However, the city is full of international organizations, and I believe that the international students can get in touch with individual faculty members that will sort of try to help them navigate this. The international students cannot work for the government, the federal government, but they can work for think tanks and in these international organizations that I was mentioning before, like the World Bank, the IMF, and so forth. But in this particular case, it's a case-by-case opportunity. And what happens with them, with these people, is that, with the foreign students, I mean, is that at the end of their studies, they will have the practicum, they will have some time period where they can stay around and work, and that's where they really can get out and compete for all the jobs that everybody else is looking at.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Vonortas. I think that's all the time that we have for this presentation today, covering the ISTP, or International Science and Technology Policy Program. I would welcome you. I'm going to skip to your last slide for your contact information. So for any students who are tuning in who have questions about the Science and Technology Policy Program, please feel free to utilize the contact information on this slide currently on the screen. So you can reach out to speak with Dr. Vonortas or Christine Gilbert, his program assistant. But thank you,
yes,
Dr. Vonortas, for tuning in today and providing this information session. It was really great, and thank you so much, and stay healthy.
Thank you, and please, indeed, I would urge anyone who wishes to get in touch with me directly via this email address, and I will direct them to the right person if I do not know the answer. Thank you.